Hello and happy new year full of coffee beans or tea leaves to fill your cups with the elixir of productive work. Speaking of work, do you know what does the heavy work for us when training neural networks? Yes, it's optimizers like stochastic gradient descent or ADAM that decide how much to update the weights of a neural network during training. Only that they need the right hyperparameters to work well, and who knows whether to set the learning rate to 0.01 or 0.0001, right? Well, you do not need to bother about optimizer hyperparameters again, because new work proposes Velo, a neural network trained to act as an optimizer that says goodbye to hyperparameters. It can dynamically decide what are the best weight updates for your problem and for your current training step. It sounds almost too good to be true, right? In this video, we will explain the Velo paper, what Velo's limitations are, and we will find out how a neural network can behave like an optimizer and how it was trained. But not before, we thank Cohere for sponsoring today's video. Since you're watching this video, we assume you already heard about the incredible advancements of natural language processing. Maybe you thought of including the latest and greatest large language models in your applications. Well, then Cohere is the right thing for you. It lets you use extremely capable language models to let them classify text for you or let them generate documents. Does this sound complicated? Fear not, because it is not complicated at all. Cohere's specialty is to take the finest transformer-based models like GPT and BERT and let them do the heavy work for you under the hood. All you need to do is to write these few lines of code to start generating text, and you don't even need machine learning skills to use Cohere. Just install with pip install Cohere and you are ready to go in Python. So what are you waiting for? Sign up to Cohere and start exploring it. They have a very generous free premium developer tier, so no credits are needed. Users bear no costs until they go to production. You can sign up with this link, also posted in the video description below. Now back to the optimizers that update the weights of a neural network during training. The optimizer determines a new, hopefully better weight for a neural network by adding or subtracting a certain value from it. The SGD optimizer determines this value to be a fraction of the gradient of the loss with respect to the weight. This basically means that we should go a step into the direction of steepest descent to minimize the loss. One very important decision that the optimizer takes is to determine how far to move into the direction that minimizes the loss. If it goes too far, it can overshoot a minimum. If it goes too little, the neural network training will take forever. Here, by using this step size as an example, we basically explained the learning rate hyperparameter of SGD. Other optimizers do even more complicated things than that. For example, they use momentum, in which the weight update of the current step uses some component of the update direction from the previous update step. But it is not a topic of today's video to give an overview about the entire zoo of optimizers. But keep in mind that there are a lot of them and there are a lot of strategies to do the weight updates. Even worse, each of these little strategies comes with a hyperparameter that decides how much of this little hack should act at a certain time step during training. For example, the learning rate can vary during the training run, and you have to decide upon a learning rate schedule. So it is hard to manually decide what is the best strategy to update the weights for each neural network and for each different dataset. Therefore, to see how well a set of hyperparameters do, one needs to do one whole training run of a network, see how low the loss gets, then change the hyperparameters and do yet another run, and then another configuration and another and so on, and this becomes really expensive really fast, until finally, after tens or even hundreds of runs, we can take the set of hyperparameters that we saw performed best. But don't worry, because this paper proposes Velo, which is a learned optimizer that can do the important decisions on its own and does not have any hyperparameters. The idea of this paper is to do meta-learning. We can use training runs of different architectures and datasets to teach a neural network to act as an optimizer. The network would take weight and gradient information and predict how to update the weights to minimize the loss of the target neural network. Of course, this idea is not new. Learned optimizers have been here for around a while, but no one has trained optimizers at this scale before and for this range of tasks, going towards a more general purpose optimizer that can be used out of the box for many datasets and applications. So how does it work? What do the authors need to do to train the VELO neural network to act as an optimizer for other neural networks? First, they need to assemble the training dataset for VELO, consisting of models of different model families, such as multilayer perceptrons, convolutional networks, residual networks, transformers, recurrent neural networks, autoencoders, variational autoencoders. And these all have different depths, layer widths, and activation functions. To augment the data, the authors even do things like reparameterizing the weights or changing the floating point precision. These models are to be trained on tasks ranging from image classification to image generation, text generation, and training learned optimizers. Keep in mind that the variety of models and tasks captured by this training data for VELO, because the variety in the training data is highly likely to determine its capabilities at test time, because models usually perform well on the type of settings they have already seen in training and fail to generalize on tasks out of distribution. No spoilers, more about this later in the video. And VELO acts like this. For every single weight, so for each scalar in the target neural network which it aims to optimize, at each time step, it predicts how much to subtract from the weight to update it. We say here subtract, but of course that if it decides to subtract a negative value, it is like it would have added something to the weight. That VELO applies to each single weight of the neural network it optimizes comes with the advantage that in this way, it can be applied to any neural network independently of its architecture and number of parameters. But the downside is that it can become really costly to apply VELO as the number of weights increases in a network. Therefore, the authors strive to keep VELO really small. The lightweight architecture of VELO is composed of a per-tensor network and a per-weight network as follows. The per-tensor network is an LSTM, which takes information about a parameter tensor. In this way, the authors make sure that when VELO predicts an update value for each parameter, the update is informed on other weights of the network. As input, the authors use, we cite, the mean and variance of parameter values, the exponential moving averages of the gradient and squared gradient as used in the Adam update. The per-tensor network also takes as input a series of additional features representing the current fraction of training completed, so it can learn training time-dependent strategies, such as learning rate schedules. Finally, our per-tensor network has access to the training loss, which can enable complex behaviors, such as detecting divergence of the loss. Then the LSTM predicts the weights of a subsequent network, the per-weight network, which is a multilayer perceptron, or MLP in short. This MLP is also extremely small, of just two hidden layers with four hidden units. This is the one that uses per-weight information, such as gradients and the value of the weight as input to predict the update for that weight. Previous work from the same authors did this differently, and the MLP took weight information and also the hidden representation delivered by the LSTM and learned its own weights. But this made the MLP's input larger, therefore slower. So the authors decide for the LSTM to train to deliver the weight of the MLP directly. And we remind you how important it is to make VELO lightweight, since it must do an inference step for each weight of a neural network during training, so its speed directly affects the training speed of the target neural network we aim to optimize. The authors train VELO to minimize the training loss at the end of the training of the target neural network. Yes, and by this we mean that an entire training run of the target network is one data point for VELO. So getting VELO to train and to converge is not a cheap task at all. The authors need roughly 4 weeks on 1000 to 5000 TPUs. Imagine that. But remember that Velo, once trained, has no hyperparameters to set, because the whole idea of this learned optimizer is to figure out by itself what the right strategy for each training step, model, and task is. So the authors argue that Velo's training cost is minimal compared to the amount of compute one saves for not having to train models multiple times to find the right hyperparameters for optimizers. So how well does Velo work in practice? The already existing benchmark the authors could use to test Velo on was the ML Commons workload, where on 5 out of 6 tasks, Velo performed better than the Adam optimizer, which had a hand-tuned learning rate schedule and weight decay. But to have a more extensive benchmark that the authors and future work can use, this paper also proposes the Velodrome benchmark that encompasses 83 tasks. The idea of these tasks is to be cheap in terms of training time, so one can test quickly, thus the 83 tasks do not need longer than an hour to train on one GPU. The other thing is that these tasks should cover a wide range of architectures, such as convolutional networks, autoencoders, ResNets, recurrent neural networks, and transformers. The good news is that Velo performs really well on these tasks, even when compared to powerful optimizers, such as NAdamW that had hand-tuned hyperparameters from more than 1,000 training runs. So Velo, that does not have any hyperparameters, could outrun an AdamW out of the box and get better performance in 85% of the cases. And it got there faster than Adam. And on half the Velodrome tasks, it was even 4 times faster than Adam. But these good results on Velodrome are a bit expected, since the Velodrome benchmark contains exactly the kind of settings that Velo was trained on this variety of architectures and short training runs. So unsurprisingly, Velo's limitations are at long training runs of more than 200,000 training steps or for large models that have more than 500 million parameters. So it fails exactly where hyperparameter search becomes more costly, in long training runs and on large models. But at least it means that Velo can help in the most standard applications, which are also the ones needed more often in practice. And that Velo underperforms in large training regimes is not necessarily the end of the story, but makes us hopeful for the future, where TPUs won't start screaming in panic that a single data point for a network is the entire training run of another network. So there you have it. This was Miss Coffee Bean's summary of the exciting Velo paper that proposes to train optimizers from data rather than hand-tuning hyperparameters. Thanks for watching and see you next time. Bye.